Good morning. Welcome back to the Broadcast Retirement Network. This is BRN AM for Thursday, February 8th, 2024. And our top story today, signs of hearing loss in children. And joining me now to discuss this and a lot more, Regina Zappi is with the American Speech Language Hearing Association. Regina, it's great to see you. Thanks so much for joining us on the program this morning.
Hi, thanks so much for having me. I'm excited to be here.
Yeah, this is a great conversation. I'm sure a lot of parents out there, their ears really perked up about this when we were talking about hearing loss in children. My first question to you is, how pervasive is hearing loss in children when you look at America in particular? Is there a lot of hearing loss among kids, and does it vary by age?
That is a great question. So in the newborn stage, 3 out of 1,000 children every year will be born with hearing loss. But as the child grows, and by the 6 to 18 year old range, we're actually seeing hearing loss at 15%. So hearing loss is actually much more common than one might think in childhood.
Yeah. And at birth, I would imagine that there could be a number of factors that impact whether or not you have a hearing deficiency. Does that come through like a birth defect or a genetic defect? Or is it something that maybe parents do with maybe a loud TV playing?
That's a great question. So a lot of the hearing loss that's present at birth can be linked to a genetic factor. We're very lucky in the U.S. that we have a universal newborn hearing screening. So every baby that's born should have a newborn hearing screening at the hospital. And if they don't pass that screening, then they're referred on further diagnosis. It is possible that during that newborn hearing screening that the baby does fail the screen, but might not necessarily have a hearing loss. And that's why it's really important to go for that follow-up.
Yeah. And I was going to say, you know, with a newborn or a young child, they don't have the communication skills yet that an adult does. So at least some of us, some of us, maybe it's kind of debatable. But how do you, is it that screening? Is that the only way to figure out? You know, there was a movie, Ghostbusters 2, and in one scene, Bill Murray does this, or maybe it was Harold Ramis, I don't remember, their character did this and this to test a newborn's hearing. But I imagine it's a lot more detailed. Is that the only way really to detect? You're not going to have a conversation with a baby on whether or not they are deficient in hearing.
Yeah, so that's a great question. So again, in that newborn stage, we do have that newborn screen. After the newborn stage, it gets a little trickier. Which state you're in, some states require a school screening, and some states it's optional. So it's really one of the, you know, greatest powers that the parents have is knowing their child best. And so if you're a parent and you're seeing some signs that there might be some hearing loss, then letting your pediatrician know that you have some concerns, and they'll likely refer you to an audiologist. An audiologist is trained to do different types of hearing tests with kids. So you're right, you're not going to be able to ask a baby, hey, can you hear that? So the screening test for a baby is usually one where the audiologist puts something in their ear, and the ear is able to respond, and the audiologist can record that. As they get older, there's something called visual reinforcement audiometry, where there are actually some toys that light up, and the child is taught to move their head around in response. So depending on their age, and the audiologist has able to get that information. And I think that's one of also a difference definitely with adult hearing loss, where, you know, in a hearing difference, an adult can go into an audiologist's office and raise their hand when they hear a beep. Not quite the same with a kid. So the audiologist is really specially trained to get that information.
Let's talk for a second, and then I will go to a commercial break, because on the back end, I want to talk about detecting the signs and what parents can look for outside of these tests, which are obviously very important part of the screening done for newborns. Let's talk about young adults. What is the leading cause of their hearing loss, or young adults? I mean, older children that can verbally communicate, they're in school, because that would have an impact on their ability to learn, at least in a traditional learning environment. So what is basically the root cause of that if it hasn't been detected at birth?
Yeah, so it is still possible that there is a genetic component where the hearing loss is just manifesting itself when the child is older. Another thing that we are seeing now is also a lot more kids and young adults that are getting hearing loss from what we call noise-induced hearing loss. So listening to their personal listening device is really loud, just being in a loud environment. So thinking about kids who take the subway every day, that can be pretty loud. So there could be a lot of hearing loss that we're finding in the older childhood population and early adulthood that could actually be caused by noise.
Yeah, and they play video games, and a lot of times you see them, they're immersed in the video game, talking to their buddies, got the headphones on. I would imagine they're playing it probably maybe a little bit too loud. Gone are the days of the Atari 2600. Regina, I need to take a very quick break. When we come back, we'll talk about some tips to help you detect hearing loss in your child. You're going to want to stay tuned right here on BRN AM. Imagine a new television network that will make you richer, healthier, and in control of your financial future. This network is for the policewoman in Nashville, Tennessee, the baker in Dubuque, Iowa, the teacher in Lexington, Kentucky. We want to make the idea of savings and retirement culturally relevant. But what do you see as a defining issue of the midterms? Especially for the smaller businesses, I mean, they are the lifeblood of the American economy. Featuring exclusive interviews, current affairs, and docuseries. 33 years old, you retired early.
The philosophy is money only matters if it helps you live a life that you love.
But you gotta start thinking about retirement as soon as you get in.
The Broadcast Retirement Network will drive very high engagement with premium partnerships. So this isn't retirement and savings for your parents or grandparents. This is for all Americans. And we're gonna change the way you think about money. Welcome to the next frontier of retirement and savings. This is BRN, the Broadcast Retirement Network.
Welcome back. We're joined this morning by Regina Zappi of the American Speech Language Hearing Association. Regina, thanks so much for staying with us. Really appreciate you hanging around for segment number two this morning.
Absolutely. I'm ready.
Yeah, we're going to do kind of a light, I don't know, lightning round. This is the second time we've done this. But, you know, you talked in the first segment, Regina, about the newborn testing. But what about, let's just say you get that done, everything's cheery, A-OK. Talk about the parents or the guardians. You know, sometimes the parents are not there. The guardians, what can they do to detect the hearing loss in a young child who, as we have established, doesn't have the ability to communicate, at least in verbally with words?
Yeah, so some signs to look out for is if you call your child's name and, you know, first, second time they don't answer you, that's that could be a sign that there might be some hearing concerns going on. Another sign too would be turning up the TV or their listening devices a little bit too loud that you feel uncomfortable. If you're feeling uncomfortable, there's probably something that needs to be looked into a little further. Another thing too is if you're having a conversation with them and they respond with something completely different, then definitely getting their hearing checked out would be a good idea. And I just wanted to mention some other ones that might not come to mind as easily. So a sign of hearing loss could be something called tinnitus, which is ringing in the ear. And for children, it might be a little bit harder because they might not have that vocabulary to tell you what it is. So they might say something funny like, I hear some bees buzzing in my ear or some popcorn pop. Really any foreign sounds that they're hearing in their ear, that's a sign for you to go ahead and get their hearing checked. And lastly, academic performance. So if someone doing really well in school and suddenly now they're having trouble. Usually when something like that happens, the parent and the teacher try to figure out what's going on with the child, and sometimes hearing is actually missed. So if something like that is going on, definitely make sure that hearing is on that checklist too.
Yeah, really, really important to, you know, I think it's a balance, right? Because, you know, parents, there are helicopter parents who everything is a problem. Again, not a parent, but, you know, we've all heard the stories. You can kind of overreact, but getting that hearing test to me, that's something probably that's covered by family medical insurance from time to time, right? So if you go to an audiologist, you know, maybe not every year, but I know at my age and in my 50s, that's covered by my insurance that I pay. I would imagine something similar for a child to be diagnosed.
Yes. Usually a hearing test a year should be covered. A great way to kind of assure that the process goes smoothly is going to your child's pediatrician first. You have some concerns and having the pediatrician refer you over to an audiologist. That way there's documentation from the pediatrician that it was medically recommended. Just to be absolutely sure, but you're right. Usually a hearing test at least once a year, especially if there are concerns, usually should be covered by insurance.
Let's play it through. Let's establish that there is a challenge with someone's hearing at a young age, at a adolescent age, and even adulthood. What can you do? All is not lost if you can. I mean, there are so many technologies available, from the over-the-counter to the prescriptive hearing aids to cochlear implants. I mean, there are a plethora of opportunities to restore hearing, at least almost to 100%.
Yes. Yeah, so early identification is so key, especially in childhood. So in childhood, the children are learning, they're learning language, they're learning in school. So you really want to make sure that they're having the best access. So if there is a hearing concern, again, going through your pediatrician, getting to an audiologist's office, based on your hearing loss and configuration and cause, the audiologist would work with your pediatrician, maybe an ear, nose, and throat doctor, and be able to tell the parent what the different choices are. The choices could be a hearing aid, it could be a cochlear implant, and it all really depends on the child. One thing I will say is that over-the-counter hearing aids are out now. They are for adults. They are not for children. There's a lot of different reasons why, but just remember that if there is a concern about a child's hearing, again, pediatrician, audiologist, and not over-the-counter hearing aids. The kid needs a lot more specialty care, and over-the-counter hearing aids are really made for adults.
Yeah, really, really good point. Regina, we're going to leave it there. Great to talk to you. Thanks so much for joining us, and we look forward to having you back on the program again very soon.
Thank you.
And that wraps up this episode of BRNAM. Have a topic of interest? Someone you think we should talk to? Drop us a line, and don't forget, for all the latest curated news and lifestyle, wellness, finance, tech, so much more in all in one place, check out today's edition of our daily newsletter, The Morning Pulse. Want to search our archives, check out our latest content? Then visit our website. We're back again tomorrow with another edition of BRN AM. We'll have a very special guest. Until then, I'm Jeff Snyder. Stay safe, keep on saving, and don't forget, roll with the changes. Now is your opportunity to co-create content around any topic on the First Lifestyle and Wellness Network. Reach a global audience through our platform and co-own exclusive branded content. All of our programs are available on demand and also as audio-only podcasts, so you can take us on the go. Broadcast Retirement Network, available anytime, anywhere, and on any device.